The era of electric vehicles has arrived. The two main parts of electric vehicles are batteries that serve as fuel and motor that acts as the engine. Modules in which motors are placed in can be divided into three main parts: an inverter that converts the direct current of the battery into alternating current, a motor that turns electrical energy into rotational motion, and a speed reducer that brings down the speed of the motor to increase the torque value. In this video, we will learn about how a motor of an electric vehicle rotates. When an electric current flows on a conductor, a magnetic field is created around it. Imagine that you are holding a conductor wire on your right hand. Where your thumb is pointing at is the direction of the current, and where your other fingers lie at are the direction of the magnetic field. The greater the number of conductors, the greater the strength of the magnetic fields. Here is a coil. If you move a magnet around the coil, an electric current will flow. The current generated by the change in the magnetic field around the coil is called induced current. Now, here's a metal rod. We'll make a hole in the middle of it like this and make it turn. When we bring a magnet close to the rod will turn towards the magnet and roll. When we move the magnet to another direction, the rod will follow that direction shortly after. And when we rotate the magnet, the rod will rotate the same way. Let's place another magnet in the place of the rod now. What we see then is that when a magnet is near another magnet, it pulls the other straight away with its magnetic force. If we rotate the magnet, the other magnet will also rotate. The power with which this rotation occurs is stronger naturally with another magnet than with a metal rod. Let's now turn the metal rod into a disc. We will place a rod in the center and make it reel. When we bring a magnet around the disc, it will roll with the magnet as before. So if we keep moving the magnet around the disc will rotate along with it. When you first think about it, you might think that the disc rotates along the magnet due to the attracting force. But it's actually a lot more complicated than that. Even if you use a metal such as aluminum that does not stick to a magnet, the disc will turn and rotate. If so, there must be some other force at work. In order to turn the motor, an electric current must be supplied. Similarly, the disc will turn if we supply electric current to it. Still, the disc turned even though there was no electric current and only magnet. It's because induced current was created by change of the magnetic field instead of externally supplied electric current. This induced current causes the disc to rotate. In order for an electric current to form, there must first be an electromotive force. Electromotive force is simply a force that causes an electric current to flow from one place to another. So, how does an electromotive force form at the disc? What you will hear next is rather difficult but essential in understanding electric motor. So please sit back and let us explain. The magnetic field of a magnet flows from the N pole to the S pole. And when the magnet moves, the magnetic field around the disc also experiences changes. It is often said that the magnetic field lines generated by the magnet are broken by the disc. So let's take a moment to go over Fleming's right-hand rule now, before we get into further details. When you open fingers of your right hand like this, the direction your thumb points at is the direction of the force, while the index finger points to the direction of the magnetic field, and the middle finger points at the direction of the electromotive force. That is, the direction in which the current flows. Fleming's right-hand rule seeks to identify the direction of this electromotive force. Here, the direction of the force indicates the direction of the motion of the conductor that breaks the magnetic flux. So when the magnet moves like this, the disc will move in this direction and break the magnetic flux. Then, the direction of the force will head this way. Since the direction of the force and the direction of the magnetic field move this way, the electromotive force will head towards the center of the disc. In other words, current will flow from the outer edge of the disc to the center. If so, to which direction will the disc rotate now? In order to determine the direction of the force at the disc, we need to apply Fleming's left-hand rule in practice. The left-hand rule aims to identify the direction of the force of the motor rotation. Since the flow of the current and the magnetic flux goes like this, the force gets headed this way. This makes the disc to gain power to rotate. As a result, the disc rotates in the same direction as the magnet does. It must have been difficult to understand. So, just remember that the disc rotates in the same direction as the magnet because of the magnetic force created by the latter. With that established, you would understand that this means that we can continue to rotate a motor if we can keep doing the same for a magnet. However, it is worthwhile to note that no change occurs in the magnetic field in the disc if the magnet and the disc rotate at the same speed. If there is no change in the magnetic field, induced current will not flow, and the disc will not rotate either. This means that the disc must rotate at a slower speed than the magnet in order to generate an electromotive force to start the rolling. This phenomenon of the disc rotating at a slower speed than the rotating magnetic field is called slip. This time, let's replace the disc with a cylinder and rotate the magnet. As we spin it like this, the cylinder starts to rotate. Now, let's find out what kind of force is acting on the cylinder. The magnetic field flows from the North Pole to the South Pole like this. As the magnet moves in this direction, the cylinder cuts through the magnetic flux in this direction. Applying Fleming's right-hand rule, this is the direction of the force, so the direction of the induced electromotive force is like this. Since the magnetic field flows this way, and the current flows in that direction, the cylinder experiences a force in this direction. On the opposite side, the same principle applies, and the force acts in the other direction. As a result, the cylinder rotates in the same direction as the magnet's rotation. How should we then turn the magnet to make sure the disc turns when the magnet does? Indeed, it would be physically too demanding to keep spinning real magnets like this. So scientists have developed this concept a bit further. You would place coil around the disc instead of rotating a real magnet, and switch the currents that run through the coil in a certain manner. Then you would enjoy the same effect of a magnet rotating. So the disc will rotate accordingly. This is how a rotating magnetic field induces rotation of the disc, and is the very principle of the induced motors. Let's take a closer look at how motors actually work now. First, let's talk about three-phase induction motors. What does phase three mean? When a magnet is rotated around the coil, currents start to flow through the coil from the change in the magnetic fields. In this process, an alternating current with this type of waveform is generated. It takes on a certain phase, and since there is only one phase that is created, it is called a single-phase current. Let's place three coils, 120 degrees apart. If we look at the shape of the currents generated by connecting the wires to the three coils, three waveforms are produced at 120-degree intervals. They are, therefore, referred to as three-phase alternating currents. When we connect the other end of the coil with a wire to tie together, this wire as a neutral wire does not show any phase. In the meantime, R, T, and S phase have 380 voltage difference from one another. Between R, T, S, and neutral wire, there is a voltage difference of 220. The electric currents produced at power plants flow into our homes and factories in the form of three phases. 380 volt, generated by three wires, is mainly used in industrial scenes for electric motors and else. While 220 volt, generated by connecting an electric wire with neutral wire, is used at home. Let's wrap the coil around the disc now. First, let us put the coil in A and pull it out on the other side. Then, insert the coil at 120 degree intervals and pull it out on the opposite side. Insert the coil back at an angle of 120 degrees and take it out the other way. Tie all the wires sticking out from A and let the three-phase current flow through the coil. A three-phase alternating current keeps changing its polarity with time. In section 1, A becomes plus, B and C become minus. In section 2, A and B become plus, and C becomes minus. In section 3, A and C become minus, while B becomes plus. In section 4, A becomes minus, while B and C become plus. Let's take a look at how current flows through the coil. Let's say that inbound flow is plus, while outbound current is minus. In section 1, only A is the inbound current, and it flows out from the other side. B, on the other hand, is outbound current and flows back in from the other side. C flows out also and goes back in on the opposite side. In section 2, A and B go in, and C comes out. Then the current will run in the opposite direction of A and B and will flow back in opposite to C. Through such process, the direction of the current flowing through the coil in sections 3 and 4 becomes like this. When current flows through the coil, a magnetic field is created, as you know by now. In section 1, the magnetic field is created in a clockwise flow, like this. Meanwhile, it runs counterclockwise on the other side, like so. Zoom out a bit now, and you will see that 3 upper coils run clockwise, while 3 on the bottom runs counterclockwise, so that we have 2 magnetic fields. This is similar to how a magnetic field flows from the N pole to the S pole of a magnet. In section 2, the magnetic field is generated like this, and in section 3, it goes like this. Lastly, in section 4, a magnetic field is created like this. It looks as if a magnet is rotating. When a rotating magnetic field is created this way, the disc will rotate along with it. From section 1 to section 4, the magnet rotated for half a turn. Since half a cycle of the waveform has passed, half a turn has been made. After one full cycle of the waveform then, the magnet will turn one full cycle, too. Increasing the frequency will increase the speed of the rotation. So, which type of motors do electric vehicles use most commonly? The most widely used motor today is permanent magnet synchronous motor. The term is quite difficult, I understand. Basically, it means that a permanent magnet is used as a rotor instead of a rotating disc. The word synchronous means that the rotation speed of the rotating magnet, and thereby the rotating magnetic field, is in sync with that of the rotating permanent magnet, which revolves on the very magnetic field. The induction motor we looked at before suggests a slip, which is a phenomenon where the disc rotates at a slower speed than the rotating magnetic field. This type of motor is called an asynchronous motor. However, since the permanent magnet type motor rotates on magnetic force rather than on induced current, no slip occurs for this type of motor. Therefore, it rotates at the same speed as the rotating magnetic field, and the rotation speed is synced. Such permanent magnet synchronous motors are referred to as PMSM in abbreviation. Torque value of PMSM is ideal and constant thanks to rotational force by magnetic force. Put in simple terms, torque means how much power you will rotate something with. High torque means large force at work to rotate an object. The reason PMSM is used in electric vehicles is because it has good torque value and is efficient. In the case of an induction motor, as rotation is initiated by rotating magnetic field that pulls the disc to spin, the rotational speed is relatively slower than other types of motor that rotates on direct current supply. The slow speed at which it rotates makes it lose much energy while rolling. It takes a lot of force to move a stationary car. When the car gains certain speed, however, it can maintain its speed with little force. As such, automobiles require high torque at low speeds. But induction motors have little volatility in magnetic field at low speed, that the induced current is kept small, and the torque also small. However, in the case of PMSM using magnetic force, it exhibits high torque from the beginning. Maximum torque value is achieved when the magnetic field of the coil and that of the magnet are 90 degrees apart. Therefore, we identify the current location value of the magnet to keep switching the current on the coil. The reason why electric vehicles can produce maximum torque value from the beginning is because they control the motors this way. Here is a three-phase induction motor. The main components here are stator and rotor. A stator is a part that produces rotating magnetic field, and coil is wrapped in the slot. To describe this in a simpler image, you have this. The three-phase current each goes in and out respectively, and with such movement, arise rotating magnetic field. As the number of coils increases, so does the power of magnetic field. Usually, the angle at which coils are placed, apart from one another, is less than 180 degrees. And this is because you can effectively save the number of coils used so that it is economical. And the waveform created from such angle is easier to manage. Although electromotive force decreases and the torque value drops with smaller angle, the advantages outweigh the disadvantages, and therefore, the above-mentioned form is commonly used. Now, no matter how tight you wrap the round coil around, there are bound to be spots that are left unfilled. To compensate for this shortcoming, a square-shaped coil has been developed. This type of coil is called a hairpin winding. If you place the coil into the slot in the form of a pin like this, a lot of empty space is filled, and the efficiency is increased. There are permanent magnets in the rotor. Permanent magnets normally use neodymium magnets that have higher magnetism than normal magnets do. The price of these magnets tend to increase as well, and the magnetism found in these types of magnets is vulnerable to high temperatures.